Is heaven a home above the clouds, at the top of the highest mountain? Or is it a place impossible to reach, impenetrable by our own efforts? Is heaven golden gated or narrow path, a court where judgments take place, a palace of pleasure, a home for all eternity? Is heaven here and now, a place for dead souls, a school for angels, or a place for resurrected humanity? Is heaven God's forever place, detached from the world, distant from all reality, remote to folk like us? I wonder, what is heaven for you? Let's bow our heads in prayer. Let us pray. God of peace and harmony, reconciler of divisions, builder of all that is good, we praise and adore your holy name. You are found on the highest mountains and in dark, deep caverns. You are found in places of beauty and in places of desolation. You are found in heaven and on earth, and everywhere we go, you are there before us. So praise God for peace. Praise God for hope. Praise God for joy. Praise God for life. Praise God for justice. Praise God for all humanity, now and forevermore. Amen. Our scripture reading today comes from Micah chapter 4 and reading verses 1 to 3. It shall come to pass in the latter days that the mountain of the house of the Lord shall be established as the highest of the mountains. And it shall be lifted above the hills, and peoples shall flow to it, and many nations shall come and say, come, let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, to the house of the God of Jacob, that he may teach us his ways, and that we may walk in his paths. Far out of Zion shall go forth the law, and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. He shall judge between many peoples, and shall decide for strong nations far away. And they shall beat their swords into plowshares, and their spears into pruning hooks. Nations shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn war any more. Amen, and may God add his blessing to this, the reading of his holy word, and to him be all the glory and praise. Since the very beginning of time, humankind has always tried to create an alternate reality, which we in our Christian tradition like to call heaven. To many, it's a place you can only reach in the afterlife, often seen as a reward for your faithfulness to God. And we have painted heaven as the best of all places. For there are no such things as shortages in heaven. There is no poverty, no war, no hunger, no famine or droughts, no Brexit, no Europe, no national identity, for we are all citizens of heaven. No racism exists, nor bigotry. Sexism of any kind is frowned upon, and it's a place of total tranquility, a place of absolute peace and glorious harmony. Yet entry to this paradise is difficult. No one is certain whether it's to be found on heaven or earth. No one knows its exact location, despite the hints of its beauty and its opulence and its godliness. You cannot get there with a map or even a sat-nav. And even the Bible paints different pictures. In the Jewish tradition, the Hebrew word for heaven is Shamayim. And it's but one part of a three-part biblical cosmology, the other elements being Eretz, the earth, and Sheol, the underworld. Shamayim is the dwelling place of God and other heavenly beings. Eretz, earth, is the home of the living, and Sheol is the realm of the dead. In the Old Testament, though, we get the following paintings of heaven. In Exodus 24, verse 10, it describes a pavement made of sapphire or lapis lazuli. Ezekiel 1 describes a throne room made of angels and God's throne being seated on a flying angel. Isaiah 6 describes an altar standing before God's throne. 2 Chronicles 18 and 1 Kings 22 describe angels to the right and left of God like prosecutors and defendants. Judaism interprets these visions symbolically rather than as literal interpretations of heaven. While in the course of the first millennium, Jewish scholars developed an elaborate system of seven heavens. Philon, or Arafel, the first heaven, is governed by the Archangel Gabriel. It's the closest of the heavenly realms to the earth and is also considered the abode of Adam and Eve. Rakia, the second heaven, is duly controlled by the angels Zechariah and Raphael. It was in this heaven that Moses, during his visit to paradise, encountered the angel Nuriel, who stood 300 parasongs high with a retinue of 50 myriads of angels, all fashioned out of water and fire. Also, Rakia is considered the realm where the fallen angels are imprisoned and the planets fastened. Shekakim, the third heaven, is under the leadership of Anahal and serves as the home of the Garden of Eden and the Tree of Life. It is also the realm where manna, the holy food of angels, is produced. The second book of Enoch, meanwhile, states that both paradise and hell are accommodated in Shekakim, with hell being located simply on the northern side. Meon, the fourth heaven, is ruled by the Archangel Michael, and according to the Talmud, it contains the heavenly Jerusalem, the temple, and the altar. Machon, the fifth heaven, is under the administration of Samael. It is also where the Ishim and the song-uttering choirs reside. Zebul, the sixth heaven, falls under the jurisdiction of Zachael. Araboth, the seventh heaven, under the leadership of Kasael, is the holiest of the seven heavens because it houses the throne of God, attended by the seven archangels, and serves as the realm in which God dwells. Underneath the throne itself lies the abode of all unborn human souls. It's also considered the home of the seraphim and the cherubim. But none of this really helps us to understand heaven. But you get the feeling that we have along the way borrowed different bits of Judaism and its seven heavens to help us describe what we think heaven might be. Yet without doubt for the Jews and Christians, heaven is a dwelling place for God, a place of longing for us, as well as a place of beauty, a place of hope, and a place for both the living and the dead. Micah sees heaven as a place for the faithful to return to, a place where our implements of war are transformed into tools for work, to create a society here and now of justice and peace. But despite this, the harsh reality is that while we are in earth, we focus more on our weapons, our rights, and our power, and we leave heaven as something unattainable, or up there, or out there. Jesus proclaimed that the kingdom of heaven was here and now. I wonder what weapons you're going to give up that will help shape the world that God longs for us all to experience. Let's bow our heads in prayer. Let us pray. God, who is in all things, who created all things, who inspires all things, help us to look for you in every corner of our world, to see you in the high mountains and the deep valleys, to recognize you when the sun shines and the rain falls, to see you in the people we encounter and to work with you in making the world a better place. Let us search for you, be it near at home, for you dwell in our streets and you invite us to participate in making heaven reality. Yet we are sorry for the fights we have caused. We are sorry for the words that have hurt others. We are sorry for actions that damage society. We are sorry for our selfishness. We are sorry for our greed. We are sorry for sucking the vitality out of living. Forgive us for such brokenness. Forgive us for the catastrophes caused. Forgive us for all the upheaval. God, have mercy upon us. Wipe out our sins and help us not to sin again. Through you, we seek justice and peace. Through you, we seek hope and promise. Through you, we seek unity and purpose. Through you, we seek life in all its fullness. And so we pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory forever. Amen. And go into the world and celebrate God in your words, thoughts and actions. Be filled with God's love. Be bursting with joy, be packed with hope, and may this Trinity of life bring you peace, now and forevermore. Amen.